That's the point I'm always missing. And man, there's a good, it's a good Google Chrome example of all the malware. And then, like, good old Buzz and Woody. Is your worm?
Yes.
Is your Trojan horse? Is your rootkit? It's pretty self-explanatory what a rootkit does. There's your ransomware. There's your keylogger. There's your grayware. All right, so United States malware. Lots of ransomware. 66%, I think. Yep. We got some backdoors, banker malware botnets, and ad fraud, and all that good stuff. This was pulled from Malwarebytes statistics for 2017. And then APAC malware was pulled from a South Korean website on internet security. And as you can see, South Korea has 67% of the people who reported, the company reported in the statistics, stated that their companies have been infected in the last week or so. So that's pretty interesting. And then 78.9% have been Trojan horses, which can pretty much, you can compare those to ransomware because they're used in the same context sometimes in exploit development. And then Trojans have been targeting companies on both continents. And they've specialized attacks for larger corporations. When you're a small corporation, you don't get targeted as specific necessarily, but larger, big global organizations will have more targeted attacks. Differences. So APAC has a lot of cryptocurrency exchanges. I think there's like 10 or 12 big ones in the South Korean area. And they're targeted by an exploit kit right now called Magnitude, and it uses the Magnabird ransomware, which is a specific ransomware targeting people in South Korea. And if you get it infected on one of your machines outside of the South Korean area, they'll usually bypass you and just say, oh, he's just someone not in South Korea. So that's pretty interesting how the algorithms do that. And then for the SamSam ransomware right now, they're using in early 2018, late 2017, it attacked the Hancock Health Hospital and forfeited, I think they were supposed to pay like $60,000. I don't believe they did pay that ransom, but it's out there. All right, so collecting the data for your honeypots. I used AWS. You can use any other platform you would like, but AWS is mostly free, and for students, they have $150 vouchers, so that's pretty interesting. Check out GitHub's, Google's, or I think it's like a coding development thing if you want. My Amazon free, maybe a couple cents a month. I think I've paid like upwards of like $1.50. That's about as much as I've paid. It's easy to deploy, and it gives you an organized hub for all of your instances when you make an honeypot network. So you can create an instance by just going to Amazon's AWS platform, selecting, I used Ubuntu Server 16.04, but it's pretty easy to deploy automatically. You can set any location, pretty much around the globe is your location. And then I use Seoul and Ohio, and they'll give you public IP addresses based out of those locations. So then you can have targeted ransomware specific for those companies once you set up a honeypot. That's pretty cool. Free tier, because it's free. Why not? If you have a Windows connection, you'll want to generate a PuTTY key from the PEM file. And then I like using SSH because it's in Linux, but it's a lot easier. So when you're installing honeypot, you're going to want to ask what data you want to collect. Do you want to collect data from SSH servers or SSH tags, web app tags, database attacks like MongoDB and MySQL? How do you want to access that data? Do you want to go from the web app or do you want to just go to the actual server? And how often do you want to check it? So like, if you want to check it once a week, once a month, once every 3 years, 5 years, however long you want to check it. I use the modern Honey network for like my command and control center. It's pretty easy, straightforward to download and get it installed on a server in a couple minutes. They have HoneyNet or HoneyPot deployment scripts for a bunch of HoneyPot open source applications. So that's pretty interesting. It's easy to manage, it's in one location. They have on their GitHub a bunch of commands you can type in. Deploying the honeypots, you just log in, deploy, select the type of honeypot you want, or if you make your own, you can set your own using their specific like XML file, I think. You can specify where you want your data to be sent. So there's MongoDB, Glasstop, I think Cowrie, I think I'm pronouncing that right. Yeah, there's no happiness without a little honey. It's always nice to have a honeypot to mess around with. You can gain a lot of information on new attacks and old attacks and automated attacks. There's a lot of botnets that go around. A bunch of automated attacks that you can analyze. So what do you do after you make all this honeypot information? You collect all the data.
E.
All right, so once you collect your data, you can upload it to Splunk or any other open source scene platform or commercial platform you want. This here is part of the Modern HoneyNet community blog. They have a bunch of people upload their honeypot information, and then you can take those feeds into Splunk, do what you wish you can with them. And then you can check source IPs and then do geolocate filters and other Splunk apps. And commands to do that, and it's pretty interesting what you can find. So what you got to answer questions, right? Because I mean, any analytical thing, you have questions. So what are they after? What are their goals, and who are they? Do we know the attackers? Do we know where they're from? Do we think they're from Russia? Do we think they're from South Korea, North Korea? Who knows? So we have command line kung fu. You can use grep. Who's heard of grep here? Anybody?
Woo!
Good people. What's grep? Yeah, you can read about grep by just name grep. And then awkward, it's nice for data extraction. So the course of action from all the data you gather, it ultimately depends on the type of data you want to collect. What I was working on was a open source honeypot for cryptocurrency exchanges, and it's still in development. I have some proof of concept code going, and I'm going to publish more on my GitHub repositories in the summer when I have a lot of free time after my OSCP exam certification. That's going to be really fun to mess with. And I have some friends in South Korea who are going to help me translate the website's files to Korean, so it'll be pretty fun. See what I can gather from that. The conclusion about US and APAC malware. Ransomware is pretty much the biggest distributor of malware for both areas currently. If I'm wrong, you can correct me later. So my future research and summer fun, I'm going to work with friends over in South Korea. I'm going to try to identify the attack methodology in the Magnitude exploit kit and any other exploit kits from now until the summer that come out and based in the Asian area. And then I'm going to Dockerize my honeypot and put it on my GitHub so people can just download the Docker file. Stuff with it. Any questions on the research? Yes.
While I'm walking my happy ass over there, in the face of technical adversity, he's got, what, 2-3 cats doing stuff up in front of his computer while he's giving the talk. Big round of applause.
Are you doing anything to hide the fact that these are honeypots, or do the attackers seem to notice that they're interacting with a honeypot?
So a lot of attackers that attack honeypots are just automated botnets. Usually they're not targeting you necessarily because they're just running a bunch of scans. I've had a lot of Shodan IPs come up when I'm doing my research, like a lot more than I expected. I know for the Google Summer of Code this summer, the HoneyNet project page has been working trying to figure out like how to make honeypots that don't like if you did a bunch of manual testing as an actual penetration tester, just a bad guy in general, a bad actor, you could find out that it's probably a honeypot because you could just see the name of the software that's installed and before it's open in the system, or find like a custom, just a basic template for the web app and say, all right, that's from the IMA honeypot or something like that.
curious if you have any research, and I don't know if you're violating any of AWS's terms of service.
Yeah, so actually, I looked at AWS's terms of service with their, they have a penetration testing agreement, and I filled out information with them. I've contacted their security department because I met them over at Eastside's Las Vegas when I was volunteering there, and I have some contacts there. So I contacted them, and I have some agreements with them saying, I don't, these are the specific IPs that I've done with my testing, and I've had some stuff with them where I'm going to like publish my research with the open source community so that they are able to like appreciate what they do.
Is that like a formal process? Or?
Yeah, it's a formal process for me. I kind of made it formal for myself because I didn't find a lot of information out there on how to do this with AWS. So I kind of just did it myself. I've been working with legal people over at Amazon Security Defense, so trying to get that.
Anyone else? All right, well, one more round of applause. We'll take a brief break and we will reconvene here in about 5 minutes, should you choose to remain on this track.